Hello, I'm Burt Lancaster. This old cruiser, the Aurora, is Russia's most historic warship. In 1917, during the Bolshevik Revolution, it was a shot from this ship that signaled the opening of the final assault on the Winter Palace in St. Petersburg, now Leningrad. In 1941, the Aurora had been retired. But even the guns of this distinguished old ship were fired against the Nazis in defense of Leningrad. The Russians fought Hitler at sea, in the Baltic, in the Gulf of Finland, in the Black Sea, the Arctic, and even on inland lakes and rivers. Soviet Marines attacked so savagely, they were nicknamed the Black Death by the Nazis. Russia's Baltic fleet rescued Soviet forces from Tallinn under a rain of Nazi bombs and a barrage of torpedo fire. The Soviet survivors returned to the great naval base of Kronstadt after an evacuation that rivaled Dunkirk. When their ships were sunk, Russian sailors fought on the land. They battled the Germans in Odessa, in Novorossiysk, in Murmansk, and they fought a 250-day defense of the fortress at Sevastopol. Each battle, a vivid chapter in the unknown war. Our story, the Battle of the Seas. A sort of a shrine. The light cruiser Aurora, laid down in 1900 in the Baltic yards. Displacement, 6,731 tons. Complements, 578. Engines, 4 steam turbines. Principal armament, 8 152-millimeter guns, 24 75-millimeter. Aurora's guns opened the Bolshevik Revolution. It was the most far-reaching salvo ever fired. The Baltic Sea. Here, Peter the Great launched Russia's first navy. Here, in 1917, Lenin began the revolution that founded the Soviet state. And here, in the early summer of 1941, the last moments of peace were spent. The Baltic was the ancient trade route between Russia and the West. Its ports, Riga, Tallinn, Leningrad herself, were prime targets for the Germans. Before the German attack began on June 22, 1941, the Soviet Baltic fleet moved to number 2 alert. Live ammunition was broken out. Out of sight of the Soviet patrols, the Nazis were stealing towards the Baltic. Before there was any declaration of war, the German Navy began to lay mines in the Gulf of Finland in the approaches to the Baltic Fleet's bases. On the morning of the German attack, the Luftwaffe arrived. Stuka dive bombers and ground attack aircraft harried coastal installations all along the Baltic shore and into the Gulf of Finland. Anything that could not fight back was destroyed.
Baltic Fleet was on alert, unlike some other Soviet forces. The state of readiness had earlier been ordered by Admiral Nikolai Kuznetsov, People's Commissar of the Navy. At 3:15 that morning, his telephone woke him. The Black Sea Fleet in Sevastopol, as well as his Baltic Fleet, was under assault. He made a crisp signal. Resist with force of arms any attempted attack by the enemy. Plan Barbarossa intended to take the Soviet naval bases in the Baltic by land. The German Army Group North battered its way along the coast toward Tallinn and Leningrad. In its path, 70 miles inside the Soviet border, lay the resort town of Liepāja, famous for its lime trees. Liepāja's garrison managed to survive for 7 days and won a kind of immortality. They lay where they fell, under the sky and the salt spray, for 3 years. With Liepāja in flames behind them, the Nazis forced their way towards Riga and Tallinn, main forward base of the Baltic Fleet in Estonia. On July 19th, Army Group North was ordered to prevent the Soviet naval forces from withdrawing from Tallinn to Leningrad. August 8th, Tallinn had been surrounded and was under bombardment by heavy guns. On a single day, the Germans dropped over 600 shells into the harbor. Sailors from the fleet were the mainstay of the defense. Among them was Yevgeny Nikonov. He was wounded and captured. Seeking information, the Germans blinded him and then poured gasoline over him and made a torch of him. Nikonov was 19. The final attack opened on August 19th against a defense force of about 20,000, two-thirds of them sailors. The heavy guns of the fleet backed them up from its moorings. Tallinn held out for another 6 days. On the 7th, orders came from Moscow to evacuate the fleet to Leningrad. The leading German infantry units were already in the streets. Soviets began to burn supplies, installations, surplus ammunition.
The Unknown War will continue in a moment.
Film of the Italian operation is rare. Nearly all the Soviet cameramen with the fleet were killed. There were 200 vessels in four convoys, 70 of them transports, with almost no air cover. Almost at once, the Nazi bombers found them, steaming north and east. They were 220 miles from home, 150 of them through a gauntlet of German shore batteries, and 75 miles of them sown with thousands of mines. To clear the minefields ahead would have needed 100 minesweepers. The Italian fleet had 10. Aboard the ships were 23,000 people, 17,000 of whom were thrown into the sea when their transports were sunk. 12,000 of them were rescued under fire. The Soviet ships went down. The destroyer, Sorovi. The destroyer, Gordi. The transport, Veronia. The transport, Kazakhstan. And the destroyer, Yakov Sverdlov. The Sverdlov became a legend by deliberately taking a torpedo meant for the flagship, the cruiser Kirov. Sverdlov lost all but three of her complement, including her captain, Alexander Spiridonov. The Baltic fleet lost 16 warships and 33 transports, but 151 vessels, large and small, got through. Leningrad, coming into the great base of Kronstadt, they were welcomed by Admiral Kuznetsov and Andrei Shdanov, leader of the Leningrad communists. Reunited, the ships of the Baltic fleet now lay at Kronstadt, in Leningrad harbor and in the Neva River. A force of two battleships, two cruisers, 13 destroyers, and over 400 smaller craft lay at Kronstadt. A total, counting shore batteries, of 400 heavy guns for the defense of Leningrad. Before the year was over, the fleet released nearly 84,000 sailors for shore duty. The ships afloat had only a third of their complements left. shore parties did not have far to march. The front line began in the suburbs of the city. The cruiser Aurora gave up her battery, the guns that had signaled the October Revolution. A generation later, they were still serviceable. The most powerful naval force lay in the Kronstadt ruins. The battleships October Revolution and Marat and the cruiser Kirov, supplementing the guns ashore. On September 4th, the Circle of Steel closed around Leningrad. The Gulf of Finland and the sea approaches to Leningrad were denied to the German Navy. Partly by the presence of the Soviet capital ships, partly by shore batteries, and partly by the Baltic Fleet's 69 submarines. But there was no denying the German Air Force. Sailors were not to be shifted. They even managed a little skylarking.
Go, 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 нам кричал. Go, 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 все нас благодарят. Go, 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 фашистам крепко льем. Готовы не поем на камбузе втроем.
The Unknown War will be back after this. The Battle of the Seas.
In the late fall, the Baltic turned savage. It was a foretaste. The winter when it came was the worst in living memory. Locked in the ice, the Baltic fleet shared the rigors of Leningrad's terrible siege. In the spring of 1942, Hitler invited the commanders of the German Navy to his villa in Bavaria. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder and Grand Admiral Karl Dönitz, architects of the U-boat war. The outcome of Hitler's conference was a renewed assault on the Baltic fleet in its anchorages. was the same. The Baltic fleet survived. At some cost. The Baltic Fleet submarine arm numbered 69. It was commanded by Vice Admiral Vladimir Tribuz. Though the approaches to the open sea had been heavily mined, the Soviet submarines came and went regularly on missions into the Baltic. Icy waters. Their targets were freighters carrying iron ore to the German war machine from Norway and Sweden, troop transports, any German warships that might venture out of port. There was no place to run to, nowhere to take cover, nothing to do but wait down in the ocean depth. Ashore, there was little certainty until the boats came into harbor. Of their successes, their failures the ocean covered. For the small craft of the Baltic Fleet, operating close inshore in surprise attacks, the action was always sharp and vicious and costly.
The Unknown War will be back after this. The Battle of the Seas.
Spring of 1943, the Nazis tightened their blockade of Leningrad and tried to bar all access to the Baltic by thickening up their minefields and laying down a submarine net across the neck of the Gulf of Finland. It was an expensive piece of engineering, and in the end, it did not contain the Baltic Fleet. We'll be right back. the spring of 1944, the Baltic Fleet put to sea. The Red Army and the Red Air Force were on the offensive along hundreds of miles of the front. The Baltic Fleet operated on their northern flank, heading for German waters, into the smoke of the Thousand-Year Reich. American torpedo boats sent on the Lend-Lease and manned by Soviet crews. Some of the latest German submarines and their acoustic torpedoes were captured. They had been used in the Atlantic. Stalin gave the technical information to Churchill. Torpedo boats, the cavalry of the sea. They had fought throughout the great patriotic war, and now they were to taste the victory. To the south, another Russian fleet rode the gentler waters of the Black Sea. Traditionally, the ice-free Black Sea ports were the only ones that could give Russia easy year-round access to the west by sea. The climate was mild, and the cities of the south were warm, colorful, Mediterranean. From the movie Battleship Potemkin, a testament to the revolution of 1905. Odessa was still a hallowed place to the Soviets. The orders from Moscow were to prepare Odessa for siege. A force of 19 divisions, all but one of them from Romania, Germany's ally, was heading for the city. The Soviets were outnumbered 8-1. The news was not good. Like their masters, the Germans, the Romanians laid waste everything in their path. They approached Odessa from Chisinau. The Soviets formed a special maritime army with sailors fighting on land beside the infantry. By the end of August, the sailors of the Black Sea Fleet had lost 40% of their number, the Marines twice that. They had exacted a price. A On August the 20th, the Nazis renewed their assault. They forced their way within 7 miles of the city. The defenders of Odessa turned to some strange expedients. Thin sheets of armor plate welded onto a tractor body gave them a vehicle they christened the Odessa Tank. Russian Navy was Varya. It called the comrades forward for the start of the last parade. September 22nd, the Marines began a series of savage counterattacks. But by now, the Nazis had bypassed Odessa and overrun the Crimea. The losses inflicted by the defenders of Odessa were enough to slow the German advance, but not to reverse it. Germans' next target was Sevastopol. The Soviet High Command judged that Odessa's landward defenses could not be held indefinitely. They ordered Odessa evacuated. It was a calm, well-organized operation. Thousand soldiers with all their equipment were embarked for the defense of Sevastopol and the Caucasus. They were victors. They had killed 70,000 Romanians, wounded 100,000 more, and sapped the Romanian army's will to fight. By the Black Sea Fleet, they approached their new epic, the Siege of Sevastopol. Behind them, Odessa became the fourth hero city of the Soviet Union, alongside Leningrad, Moscow, and Stalingrad. Thank you.
The unknown war will continue in a moment. The Battle of the Seas.
Sevastopol, the Soviets' principal naval base in the Black Sea and Russia's Gibraltar. The nine-month siege of Sevastopol began on October 30th, 1941. The Germans had overwhelming air superiority, and some Soviet pilots chose the heroic but desperate expedient of ramming their enemies in midair. The Soviets were outnumbered 2-1. They had 50,000 troops inside the fortress, 21,000 of them Marines. 125,000 bombs were dropped on the city in the 9 months. Germans brought up a super-heavy howitzer. It had long since reduced the Belgian and French forts. Now it went to work on Sevastopol. Shelled incessantly, the inhabitants of Sevastopol went underground. Inside the towering cliffs of the North Bay, there were huge caves and labyrinths of tunnels. The wounded could be treated in safety. Anastasia Chausch continued to work at a factory in one of the caves, though she had lost a hand from a bomb explosion. She was 16. Shells, mortar shells, mines, grenades, 24 hours a day. The caves also sheltered armored trains mounting naval guns. Russian sailors performed an act of extraordinary heroism. Tying bundles of hand grenades around their bodies, they threw themselves under the advancing tanks. They were Nikolai Filchenkov, Ivan Krestoselsky, Vasily Sibulko, Yuri Parshin and Daniel Odintsov. Not even snapshots were left. The garrison of Sevastopol numbered 106,000, the majority of them sailors. The message reads, death to Hitler. On June 7th, 1942, the Germans launched their final assault. Von Manstein, the German commander, could see the whole battle line as it ground back and forth. With the enthusiasm of a connoisseur, he wrote, "By day, one saw the clouds of rock and dust cast up by the bursts of our heavy shells and the bombs dropped by German aircraft. It was indeed a fantastic setting for such a gigantic spectacle." The armored train made its last journey when a bomb hit the tunnel. On June the 30th, after 2 days of vicious street fighting, the Germans reached the port area. 4 days later, the fortress surrendered. In their final assault, the Nazis had hurled 46,000 tons of ammunition into the city and dropped 20,000 bombs. Scarcely a building was left standing. The siege had lasted 250 days and nights. The 30,000 citizens of Sevastopol survived the siege. Of these, two out of every three were either deported to slavery in Germany or shot out of hand. It had been a fight to the very end. Now the Nazis were masters of the whole Crimea. Hitler celebrated prematurely. Before them lay the Caspian and the rich oil fields of Baku, theirs for the taking. Or so they thought. The mark of the Nazis never fell on Baku. The Germans might be victorious on land, but they could not command the sea. There, the Black Sea Fleet defied them. In the spring of 1944, the Marines of the Black Sea Fleet returned to the Crimea by the Sea Road, in force. To recapture Sevastopol. And then the Black Sea Fleet came home. Day is celebrated on May 9th in the Soviet Union. It is also Memorial Day. On that day, every year on the Baltic Sea off Tallinn, where the Baltic Fleet fought for its life in 1941, the Russians remember. Remember all their sailors. In the Arctic seas of the far north. In the Black Sea to the south. In the Baltic. Mm-hmm. they remember the courage, the sacrifice of those who sailed in the unknown war, who rest forever in the timeless sea. Our next story, the Battle of the Caucasus. Hitler's plans for world domination called for his armies to open a road to the Mideast and India through the Caucasus Mountains in the Soviet South. After that, Hitler promised he would bring the war to the United States. The fight to deny this Nazi threat was one of the longest in the unknown war.
Wednesday, how tanks on the battlefield measure up to tough modern-day technology on America at War. Later on Our Century, the political legacies of Hitler and Mussolini in Dictators, the Rise of Fascism. All Wednesday on A&E. Now stay tuned for Tumbledown on A&E Premieres. Next.